first chapter, verse number 13. Please repeat after me. Nesha dissaha chunmam. Takto dhammapi baddhate. Pibantantan mukham bhoja. Putam hari katha amritam. Word to one's translation. Na, not. Aisha, all this. Ati dussaha, extremely difficult to bear. Shut, hunger. Ma, unto me. Taktva udam, even after giving up drinking water. Api, also. Badhate, does not hinder. Pibantam, while drinking. Tvat, mukham bhoja putam. Tat mukham bhoja putam. Emanating from your lotus mouth. Hari katha amritam, the nectar of topics concerning Krishna. Translation by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Because of my vow on the verge of death, I have given up even drinking water. Yet, because I am drinking the nectar of topics about Krishna, which is flowing from your lotus mouth of your Lordship, my hunger and thirst, which are extremely difficult to bear, cannot hinder me. Purport. To prepare to meet death in 7 days, Maharaj Parikshit gave up all food and drink. As a human being, he was certainly both hungry and thirsty, and therefore Shukdev Goswami might have wanted to stop narrating the transcendental topics of Krishna. But despite his fast, Maharaj Parikshit was not at all fatigued. The hunger and the thirst from my fast do not disturb me, he said. Once, when I felt very thirsty, I went to the ashram of Shamik Muni to drink water, but the Muni did not supply it. Therefore, wrapped a dead snake over his shoulder, and that is why I was cursed by the Brahmana boy. Now, however, I am quite fit. I am not at all disturbed by my hunger and thirst. This indicates that although on the material platform there are disturbances from hunger and thirst, on the spiritual platform, there is no such thing as fatigue. The entire world is suffering because of spiritual thirst. Every living being is Brahman or a spirit soul and needs spiritually food to satisfy his hunger and thirst. Unfortunately, however, the world is completely unaware of the nectar of Krishna Katha. The Krishna consciousness movement is therefore a boon to philosopher, religionist and people in general. There is certainly a charming attraction in Krishna and Krishna Katha. Therefore, the absolute truth is called Krishna, the most attractive. The word Amrita is also important, a reference to the moon. And the word Ambuja means lotus. The pleasing moonshine and the pleasing fragrance of the lotus combine to bring pleasure to everyone hearing Krishna Katha from the mouth of Shukdev Goswami. As it is said, Materna Krishne Parita Satova Mitho Abhipadyate Grahavratanam Adanta Gobir Vasitam Tamishram Puna Punascharvita Charvananam. Because of their uncontrolled senses, persons who addicted to materialistic life make progress towards hellish condition and reputedly chew that which has already been chewed. Their inclination towards Krishna are never aroused, either by instruction of others, by their own efforts, or by a combination of both. Srimad Bhagavatam 7.5.30. At the present moment, all of human society is engaged in the business of chewing the chew. Punha punascharvita charvananam. People are prepared to undergo mrityu sansara vartmani, taking birth in one from dying, accepting another from and dying again. To stop this repetition of birth and death, Krishna Katha or Krishna consciousness is absolutely necessary. But unless one hears Krishna Katha from a realized soul like Sukadeva Goswami, one cannot relish the nectar of Krishna Katha, which puts an end to all material fatigue and enjoy the blissful life of transcendental existence. In relation to Krishna consciousness movement, we actually see that those who have tasted the nectar of Krishna Katha lose all material desires, whereas those who cannot understand Krishna or Krishna Katha regard the Krishna consciousness life as brainwashing and mind control. While the devotees enjoy spiritual bliss, the non-devotees are surprised that the devotees have forgotten material hankerings. Om Ajnananti Mirandhasya Jnananjanashalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurve Namaha Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangulingayate Girim Yadikrapatam Hammande Shri Guru Dinatarinam Vanchakalpatrubhaischa Kripasindubhai Vichapatitanam Pavnebhyo Vaishnavabhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityanand Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasadi Gaur Bhaktavrind Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So I'll first of all seek the blessing of all the Vaishnavas, although surely not qualified to speak the subject matter of Srimad Bhagavatam. But since order is given, so taking strength from the instruction of superiors, will try to purify myself and speak something. Of course, I'll go paragraph by paragraph wise, in every paragraph, what I felt that Prabhupada is highlighting a particular point of what is important. So I'll just begin. But first, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So, the first, how this verse, when Parichit Maharaj is saying that Pibantim Tvan Mukham Bhojam Putham Hari Katha Amritam, he's saying that the nectar that I'm drinking from your lotus mouth is what he's doing is my hunger and my thirst. What about hunger? I have given up drinking water even. So you are, because you are speaking Hari Katha from a lotus mouth, this hunger or this thirst is not hindering me in the process of hearing Hari Katha from yourself. That means this, because you are speaking Hari Katha from a lotus mouth, so the hunger and thirst is not bothering me. So I can continue your hearing. But the what is the achepa? Why Parikshit Maharaj is saying this thing? What is the need of saying this thing? What is the need of this verse? So this has to be discussed. So it is mentioned in the Prabhupada. Prabhupada said that Sukadeva Goswami might have wanted to stop narrating the transcendental topics of Krishna. So Parikshit Maharaj, in one sense, like he's feeling like Sukadeva Goswami could have said, see, you are hearing Srimad Bhagavatam from so many days, you know, 4 or 5 days or 4 or 5 nights. So now, again, I can continue, but do you need some rest? Do you need some break? You must be feeling some hunger, some thirst. So he's immediately saying, no. I do not feel any hunger, any thirst. These are not at all bothering me. Why? Because I'm hearing the nectar of Hari Katha from your lotus mouth. So you keep on speaking Hari Katha. It's not bothering me. But if you stop, then there will be a problem. Then there will be hunger, there will be a thirst. And that will give me the trouble, and I could have died also. And he's also indicating, you remember last time I went to the hermitage of Shambhik Rishi, I was thirsty, and you know what disaster took place, I did a great mistake. So please don't stop, continue to speak. So that is what this Parikshit Maharaj is saying, and that is the need of the verse. So when first time I was reading this translation, when he's making such a statement, bold statement, I'm drinking the nectar of topics of Hari Katha. I'm not at all disturbed by the thirst and hunger. So I was really appreciating Parikshit Maharaj. What a statement, what a bold statement he has given. Only Parikshit Maharaj could have said this. I do not need to eat anything. I do not have any thirst. because I'm hearing the nectar of Harikatha from a lotus mouth. What a consciousness, what a level of Parikshit Maharaj. So when we hear Srimad Bhagavatam, or when we read Srimad Bhagavatam, of course we are here to do the analytic study, see the commentaries of the Acharyas, making them justify the purport. These all things there, we should do it. Surely we are here for this only. But at the same time, if by hearing the character of Srimad Bhagavatam, like Parikshit Maharaj, Pahlad Maharaj, or Chitraketu Maharaj, if we are not able to develop a genuine appreciation in our heart, if we are unable to appreciate their glories in our heart, if we are not able to appreciate the gratitude for the Prabhupada, for the purport that is given, Bhaktivedanta purport, then for myself, I can say, instead of doing something, I'm really missing something substantial. So the point is, our heart should be filled with the glories of the character of Srimad Bhagavatam. Actually, that is what is nourishes a devotee. When we face so many problems in our life, problem from our own mind, problem from the people around, there's so many problems. But how we come up from those problems, when we really genuinely appreciate the qualities of a character of Srimad Bhagavatam, when we fill our heart with the Srimad Bhagavatam, then we are not much, the problems are not botheration for us. We are not much disturbed. Because the heart, we are getting nourishment from the character of Srimad Bhagavatam. So this is the point I was thinking, it's my meditation. I wanted to share with you that glories, our heart should be filled with the glories of the character of Srimad Bhagavatam. Of course, only Prabhupada, this Parikshit Maharaj can say that while hearing the Harikatha, he forget the hunger and thirst. But this is the level of Parikshit Maharaj. So sometimes anybody can say, Prabhu, why are you talking about eating? Why are you talking about drinking juice and all that? Parikshit Maharaj could have said this. I don't need any hunger. I don't feel the thirst. But why you are talking about this eating and such thing? But no, there's a level of Parikshit Maharaj. We can't imitate him. It is for myself, can't imitate him. It's a very, very high level, Mahabhagavat devotee. At our level, we need something to eat. We need something to drink. So therefore, there is a whole management system is there. Prabhupada, our founder Acharya of International Society for Krishna Consciousness, he designed this whole program of the day. That they put fixed time for the Mangala Arati, fixed time for Bhagavatam class, fixed time for Prasadam. So you eat nicely and come in the class and hear. And inquire if you have some inquiry. So, thirst or hunger is not the point. The point is hearing Shri Katha, eagerness to hear Hari Katha. Of course, if someone is on that level that he can hear Hari Katha for hours and hours, he does not need any eat, and he doesn't feel any hunger, any thirst, wonderful. It's amazing. This person says, we admire him. We should offer our respectful obeisances at his lotus feet. We are on such a level. But at my level of consciousness, I have my needs. I need some prasadam. I need something to drink. So the point is, hearing or thirst is not the point. The point is how we can test our develop for hearing Atikatha. So sometime at our level, sometime the Bhagavatam class, speaker extends. So when we say, oh, what are you doing? He said, class ending, it's time for eating. True, it should be. In general, we should end the class on time. But sometime with our elevated speaker, who have something to share with the audience, and audience also want to hear. So sometime, it's not a general statement, but sometime when you can extend the class for 5 minutes, 7 minutes, 10 minutes. But in general, class should end on time, and we should take prasadam on time. But what is the purpose of eating? Developing the taste in Harikatha. That should be our motto of our eating and drinking. So, sometimes people says that bhukhe pet bhajan na hoye gopala. Prabhu, what you are talking about, Harikatha, mujhe khana chahiye, I need to feed my stomach, otherwise I can't focus on Krishna. So yes, that's true. But at the same time, we also see that there are so many people outside, very, very rich people. The background which I came from, I used to interact every day with so many rich, rich people, like Birlas and Tatas. I have interaction with Aditya Birla. So such people, they are eating very nicely. Like, I know people who are eating all the time. Constantly, they are something they are chewing. But are they engaged in Krishna consciousness? Are they practicing bhakti? So they are filling the stomach properly, even over stomach, fill their snack, fill till their neck. But are they interested in Harikatha? No, it's not that. Because if it is like that, then the half of the population of this world could have turned into a devotee. So eating or thirsting is not the point. The point is, eating or thirst, or hunger or thirst, is not the problem. The problem is the lack of seriousness of hearing Harikatha. That is the problem. The problem is the lack of testing, the lake of taste of Harikatha. That is the problem. The problem is the lake of eagerness in Harikatha. That is the problem. So this is, we should understand this principle. Now, how to develop a eagerness to Harikatha? How, what we should do that we can develop the eagerness to hear Bhagavatam class? But of course, there can be various ways. One way is, if we want to develop eagerness for Harikatha, then we have to associate with those devotees. Those are relishing Krishna Katha. They are really enjoying Krishna Katha in their personal life. Those are enjoy. I mean, sometimes they forget their hunger and thirst. It happens. We see in the situation of devotees. Even sometimes we have some hungerness or we have some thirst. But when we have a darshan of the Lord, we forget that particular time. Or when we are hearing Srimad Bhagavatam, we forget also. So if we want to develop that eagerness of Harikatha, we should associate with those devotees who have developed that taste for Harikatha, who has some realization to good extent in their heart of Srimad Bhagavatam. So when we associate with them, when we hear from them, then we can get that by their mercy, we can get this eagerness of Harikatha. And especially when such elevated soul pray for us, when we go and request to pray for us, when they offer their blessings, then Krishna hear those prayers of elevated devotees, and then he shower his blessing. So we can develop taste in that way also. And also one general answer, if you want to have an eagerness for Harikatha, associate with those devotees, those who are eager for it, those who have this quality of eager. So the another aspect is to develop eagerness for Harikatha is sometimes the process of Krishna consciousness is so broad that there are so many aspects of Harikatha, and naturally one is have a eagerness for any aspect of Krishna consciousness. Some have a eagerness for Hari Shrimad Bhagavatam class, some may have eagerness for singing kirtan, some may have eagerness for distributing the book. So whatever aspect of Krishna consciousness inspire him, he should engage his eagerness in that particular aspect. He's keep on engaging. But sometimes this happened, like for example, when in the morning hours, when it announced that today Bhagavatam class is given by such and such Prabhu, and suppose this Prabhu is our favorite speaker, immediately the sleep has gone. Immediately mind goes, how to prepare, how to come in the class, where I will sit, how can sit attentively. How we plan a whole day immediately, because we don't want to miss the class, because he's our favorite speaker. So we have that eagerness for that particular speaker, develop that. Hear from him rather than going out. Sometimes it is, see, people have a eagerness, devotee have a eagerness, but sometimes they're busy talking something, doing something, not so much serious to coming in the class. No, but Krishna bestows this eagerness to you. So come in the class, hear the class, ask something if you have any query. So when we develop this way, then Krishna bestows the eagerness. Because first Krishna see what I have given is engaging in my service or not. If we engage properly, then we ask for more eagerness, then Krishna gives. But if suppose Krishna gives some talent, some skills, and we are not engaging it properly with the eagerness, then Krishna will say, kya jo diya hai, wo hi nahi kar raha hai abhi to. Whatever is given to him, he is not utilizing it properly and asking for the more. But to get the attraction of Krishna, to get the mercy of Krishna, whatever is given to us, whatever skills, talents, knowledge, the eagerness in a particular aspect of Krishna consciousness, we should engage in that particular aspect. And by the blessing of Krishna, we can develop eagerness, no doubt. Of course, while developing that eagerness, one may face some problem. Some difficulty may come. Krishna purposefully keep the difficulty sometime. Like yesterday, 7 p.m. to 7 a.m., there was no power in my room. There was no inverter facility. So I took opportunity. This is a time to show my eagerness to Krishna. No, Krishna, I want to serve you. I really want to serve your devotees. So this is the way. Whatever eagerness we have to engage it, invest it, and then by the mercy of Krishna, we get that eagerness. This is the one way. And now, in the second purport, Prabhupada talks about the entire world is suffering because of spiritual thirst. When a person is diseased or a patient, when goes to the doctor, so he tells so many problems to the doctor. I have a headache, I have a stomach problem, I have a leg pain, I have a back pain, so many problems. But an expert doctor, what he does? He just hears, but he diagnoses the exact disease. He understand what he's telling is actually the symptoms only. Where is the problem? He understand that. And accordingly, he diagnosed the medicine for it. He diagnosed the disease for it. So similarly, Srila Prabhupada, who the spiritual doctor of the whole world, is exactly diagnosing the disease of the materialistic people, why they are suffering, why they are miserable. And he's saying the entire world is suffering because of spiritual thirst. Because there are so many people outside who are materially very elevated, big house, big bungalow, big things, but still they are hankering for a spiritual thirst. Like one time, in one of the hotel, Mumbai Taj, I was given a service of Aditya Birla. He was coming in our hotel. The whole circular is circulated, and everyone knows that I'm going to look after him. I made a big arrangement, so many things did, 15 minutes before preparation, 15 minutes after to take wind up. And at the end, when I went to his room, I was talking to him, sir, you must be very happy, such and such thing. I really remember his words. And that was a first turning point in my personal life. Because I was thinking, such a great man, he's Birla, Aditya Birla, he's belonged to such a rich family, one of the richest family in India. But he was saying to me, see, people think that I'm very much happy. And he spoke his problem, what is going to facing through in his family life, and the problem, official problem, the problem of the people of this world, how much people are envious. He was literally crying. So I was thinking, hey, I'm also to do earn this money and do enjoy such thing, but this person himself is suffering so much. That means I'm in a wrong track. I have to do something. Then I was thinking about spiritual life. So that's why there are so many people who are rich, but they need, even there everything is given to him, spiritual thirst is there. And on the contrary, on the other side, we see devotees who are really spiritually satisfied, who spiritually is strong. So even they don't get their material facilities sometime due to some reason, what they need is their need, but they are unable to get for whatever reason. But we see that they are happily going on their Krishna consciousness. They are not much disturbed. They can express their need, but if doesn't get, then they are not much bothered, not much disturbed. Why? Because their spiritual need is fulfilled. That was the Prabhupada making the point in this purport. The spiritual thirst is the root of the problem. Even when have a materialistic person have so many things in their life, they are still suffering because they want something. Other hand, devotee may not have some material facilities what he needs, but still they are satisfied. They are joyful. Joyfully they are practicing the process of Krishna consciousness. And then for the third purport, third paragraph of the purport, Prabhupada saying the word Ambuja is also an important referred to the moon. And the word Ambuja means lotus. So, Srila Bhakti Vishwanatha Chakri Thakurpat comments in this way. He says that Ambuja means lotus. And the word indicates sweetness and the intoxicating effect of the topic of Lord Hari. So, what was the reason why Parikshit Maharaj was saying that I do not feel any hunger, I do not feel any thirst, because of these two aspects of Hari Katha, the sweetness and the intoxicating effect of the Krishna, of the Hari Katha, which is coming from the lotus mouth of Shukadev Goswami. This was the thing, he forgot his hunger and thirst. And he's saying, you keep on continuing. But if you stop, then there will be a problem. So please continue. I want to hear. He was so much eager to hear. In previous verse, in 12th verse, he asked so many questions. Why, how Lord Krishna has appeared? He asked about Lord Balarama. So many questions he asked. And he said, what I asked, you explained that. But you also explained why did not ask. If you feel that I need to know it, please explain in a great detail. So that was his eagerness. And then further Prabhupada said in the same purport, the pleasing moonshine and the pleasing fragrance of the lotus combined to bring pleasure to everyone because Krishna Katha from the mouth of Shukadev Goswami. Mm-hmm. So Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur said in this regard, Amrita means nectar, and this word indicate the mouth of Shukadev Goswami, Mukham Bhuja, is like a moon. So lotus mouth of the Shukadev Goswami is compared with the moonlight and the fragrance of the lotus. What is the function of the moon? What moon exactly does? He nourishes the lotus. He nurtures and nourishes the vegetables, the fruits through his moonlight. That is a function. So because Shukadev Goswami is constantly, is continually nourishing the heart of Shukadev Goswami, so therefore is compared with Mukham Bhoja. The word is Ambuj and Amritam. And then further, Srila Prabhupada said, he's again, he's a very practical acharya. He speak the purport, he write the purports in a way that the current audience can relate in personal life and take the benefit. So immediately he's addressing, what about the outside people? What's wrong with them? Why they are unable to develop the test? What is the reason? So he's saying, Materna Krishna, 7th canto, Prahlad Maharaj says, Materna Krishna, आवाज़ थोड़ा कम हो गया, परता सतोवा मिथो अभिपद्यते ग्रह वेताना अनांत गोबे विषितम तमिश्रम पुनः पुनश्चर्वित चर्वनाना. So he's saying, Materna Krishna, the people, the materialistic people who are always absorbed in sense gratification, whole goal of their life is ahar nindra bhay or methun, their mati cannot be engaged in Krishna. Why? What is the reason? Why cannot be engaged? Because adant gobhir, because of uncontrolled senses. So their senses are so much uncontrolled, even an elevated person who is spiritually elevated or a devotee instruct them, or even themselves put the endeavor to develop a taste for Harikatha, they are failed because their senses are uncontrolled. And then Prabhupada said, in the present moment, all human society is engaged in the business of chewing the sweet. So a conditioned living entity, what he is doing? If he gets a form of an animal, or he gets a human form, or he gets a demigod form, in any form, a conditioned soul, what he is doing exactly? Puna punascha charvita charvana. He is doing the same activity of sense gratification. It's like the same thing, but in different packaging. So Prabhupada is beautifully diagnosing the nature and the destination of a materialistic person. The nature and destination of a sense gratifier, because they have uncontrolled senses and they are engaged in the sense gratifier activities, Aharnindra Bhaya Methun, what is their destination? They are going towards hellish life. They are progressing towards hellish life, day after day, week after week. So they are going towards that life. In the same purport, Prabhupada is mentioning a very beautiful point. He says, this really touched me. He said, unless one hears Krishna Katha from a realized soul like Shivdev Goswami, one cannot relish the nectar of Krishna Katha, which puts an end to all material fatigue. So of course, we talk about hearing Srimad Bhagavatam, developing taste for Srimad Bhagavatam, hearing eagerness to hear Srimad Bhagavatam. So Prabhupada is making the point, hearing is important, no doubt, Shravanam. The nine angas of bhakti, Navada bhakti, the basic foundational part or basic foundational anga is Shravanam. All other angas, all other eight parts of the Navada bhakti is depend on Shravanam. If Shabda takes place properly, then all other thing takes place properly. So hearing is important, but what is more important? From whom we are hearing. Hearing is important, but the more important is from whom we are hearing. And in Bhagavad Gita 7.1, which is that verse, Maya Sakt Manaha Partha Yogam Junjan Madashraya Asanshaya Samagram Mam Yathagja Jati Tashru. Just hear from me, O Arjuna. Krishna says to Arjuna. So in that purport, Prabhupada writes that if one wants to develop a taste for Harikatha, or one wants to have a realization in Krishna consciousness, then there are two ways. One, he should directly from Krishna. Hearing directly from Krishna means hearing from Bhagavad Gita, he writes like that, or hearing from his pure devotees. And he further writes, to develop the taste of Harikatha, one should hear from Krishna directly, that means through Bhagavad Gita, or hear from his pure devotee, not from a non-devotee, upstart, puffed up from material qualification, who is academically very qualified. So we see outside there are so many professional reciter, they are materially very qualified. I know one devotee who went to a Bhagavad Katha. So I said, how was your experience? He said, oh, what a speaker, what sloka is speaking, one by one after another, he was speaking verses and verses, speaking beautifully Sanskrit. And the people are very much impressed with the way he was speaking the shlokas. But again, the same thing, as Kanaka Prabhu was telling that day, if we hear from a professional reciter, and it's like drinking a poison, drinking a milk, which is touched by a servant. So therefore, Prabhupada is saying one should hear from the Shukdev Goswami or his representative was coming down on his parampara. That's a very important thing. And then further, at the end of the purport, Prabhupada says, those who have tasted the nectar of Krishna Katha lose all material desires. So sometime when we think, now I got a taste for Hari Katha. I'm attending class regularly. I'm attending the whole morning program. I do all sadhana. I do every sadhyaya. So I'm fine. I have a taste. But no, Prabhupada is saying, what is the symptom of a person who developed the taste for Hari Katha is clearly saying. Like in Bhagavad Gita 2.54, Prabhupada says that in this world, everyone is recognized by the symptom that he carries, symptom that he has. If you are a rich person, then surely you must have some symptoms. If you say, I'm a poor man, then you have some symptoms. If you say, I'm a healthy man, there must be some symptoms. If you say, I'm a diseased man, there must be some symptoms. So person is recognized by the symptom that he has. So similarly, if one may feel that I have got a taste in Harikatha, then Prabhupada is saying his symptom is he will lose all material tastes. He has no material desire. Oh, he may have, but he's comfortably can control it because he got the taste for Harikatha. And we see in the situation of devotees, there are devotees who have come to this platform, they really develop the taste. And then very practical point Prabhupada is making that Krishna consciousness life, whereas those who cannot understand Krishna or Krishna Katha regard the Krishna consciousness life as brainwashing and mind control, while the devotees enjoy spiritual bliss, the non-devotees are surprised that the devotees have forgotten material hankering. So sometimes outside people really think, what do people are doing? Are you all of having such instruction? What do people are doing? You remove all your hair in the outside world. The hair is the main attractive part. People get attracted by the hairstyle. But you remove your hair, when Mataji told you, you remove your hair all, hairs only. And what? There is no TV in your life. There is no dance. There is no discotheque, no pub, no drink, no alcohol, no meat eating. You left all the taste. So they really wonder how you people are enjoying. They just can't understand. Devotee comes at 4 o'clock in the Mangala Arati and they are dancing. It is undigestible for them. How can one dance at 4 o'clock? Aray, this is a time for sleeping. You people are enjoying. Similarly, devotee also wonder when he see the non-devotees, how can they enjoy drinking alcohol? How can they enjoy cigarette? How can they enjoy meat eating? So the way the materialistic people live, devotee also doesn't digest this, how they are enjoying. I remember one time I was sitting in ISKCON Vrindavan at my welcome desk. So since there was not much rest, so I was absorbed in reading my Bhagavad Gita. Suddenly, when Mataji, outside Mataji came, and she literally attacked on me. Without any talking, she directly came and said to me, what you are doing here? I was really wondering what I'm doing. She said, see, you are such a young boy, a smart boy, you are highly educated, you people, ISKCON people, and you are left the whole thing. What is the use of your life? You are not enjoying. Your life is meant for enjoy. Are go to the pub. Mata is saying to me, are go, have a drink, enjoy with the girl, enjoy life, man. So I tried to explain him. Before I tried to explain him, she said, I'll claim with the ISKCON people. She was so angry with this point. She said, I'll claim with the ISKCON. I said, why? She said, she has a problem with ISKCON. She said, see, what ISKCON people does? What they are doing, they are catching all the good, young, smart people from the society. And they keep with them. And they brainwash, I was talking about brainwash, and she said, they say they don't get married. And what the other girls will do? From they will get the good boys. All good boys, ISKCON is capturing. And how will we will get our marriage done by our daughters? So I said, no, Mataji, it's not like that. There are many devotees. They are grihastha ashram, they get married. No. She was not at all much specified. So after some discussion, she specified. And then she, can you come to meet my family members? So I said, okay, if that was pleases her, I'll go and meet their family members. But I didn't know what are the family members. So I just went ahead with her. So he called his one daughter. So she, what's her name? I said, Satrenda. She's Satrenda. What's her qualification? I explained degree in hotel management. She said, see, he's such a boy, such a nice boy. No, he's spoiling his life. There is no girl in his life. What do you will enjoy? Then he called his another daughter. Another came. So you won't believe there was not only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. She had 7 daughters. And each one of them, she's introducing me. And the all daughter was also watching me in a, kya bolte hain, lalchi aankhon se. Watching me. I just offered my obeisances and I ran away.
I remember that. I said, thank you, Raj Mataji. So time for my service, I leave. So the point is, they are unable to understand how you people are enjoying. What is the rasa in your life? But devotee knows what is the rasa. What is the joy in get up early in the morning? Only devotee knows. What is the power of getting up in the Brahma Muhurt? Devotee understand that. And that's why when we are facing so much difficulty in the situation of devotees, we have so many problems in problem relationship, the various problems. Every day something happens, life of a devotee. Every day some disturbance is there on material platform, on external platform. But still devotees are joyfully going, wonderfully growing in their life, and they keep continue with the situation of devotees because they know this is the real life of enjoyment. Satchit Anand. This is the real eternal life, life of real knowledge, blissful life. But non-devotee is very difficult for to understand sometimes. They really can't digest. What you will do? One of my friend told me, "Arey, fayda kya jine ka? Jine ka, mera jine ka matlab kya?" So he said, "Arey, kuch sharab piyo, maas khao. Yehi isliye to life mili hai. The fayda kya hai?" But devotee just can't digest such things. So this how I can speak on this purport. Of course, one point I forgot. I want to repeat here. Like when we're discussing so much about hunger and thirst, that on a spiritual platform, one has a living entity, has a spiritual body, then he doesn't need eat anything, he doesn't feel hunger, he doesn't feel thirst. Then the question comes in one mind, then what this Krishna's friends are doing? Why they are eating? Why every day they are eager for getting their lunch box and eating with Krishna? Why the gows are so much eager to eat grass? When there is no hunger, there is no thirst, then what is the role of eating? What is the role of the Brajvasis are eager to drink water from Yamuna? Then why it is like that? So there can be various reasons. One reason is the Brajvasis, when they talk about hunger, when they talk about thirst, when they trying to fill their belly, it is just to give enjoyment to Krishna. It is enjoyment to increase the glories of the pastime of Krishna, to increase the enjoyment of Krishna, not to fulfill their own hunger, not to fulfill their own thirst. So it's not for their own sense gratification. Their hunger and thirst is to gratify Krishna. Their hunger and thirst to give pleasure to Krishna and his devotees. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.